In this screencast, we will analyze a process which is a naturally interacting system. An interacting system is one where, in order to get from the input variable to the output variable, one does not follow a sequential order of intermediate variables. So, in order to illustrate this, we'll take a look at a tank who, because of imperfect mixing, we're going to approximate the process as a tank splits in two parts, each well mixed. And our goal here is to determine the transfer function that relates how a change in the inlet concentration in deviation variables will affect a change in the outlet concentration in deviation variables. And to look at our process and to show why it's interacting, what's coming in is a flow rate F and an inlet concentration Cn. And in order to go from C in to C out, we need this intermediate concentration, C1. However, C1 is not just a function of C in, it is also a function of C out. Why? Because of the recirculating stream shown here. The recirculating stream is an equal flow rate FR is going from volume 1, the upper part, to volume 2, the lower part. But since this is well mixed, the concentration of the outlet coming out of the lower portion is equivalent to that concentration inside the tank. So therefore, this concentration will be C out. Now that we see the fact that we have an interacting system, let's develop the mass balances to describe the process. So here, a total mass balance on the process will be unnecessary because what we'll show is that F equals F. So instead, what we're going to focus on is component balances. Because there is no reaction here, our balances are going to be pretty straightforward. It's going to be accumulation equals in minus out. And we're going to analyze this for both the upper portion and the lower portion. So for the upper portion, what is coming in, we have two inlet streams coming in. The first is what's coming in from the general inlet, F times Cn. And the second is what is coming from this stream here, which is going to be Fr multiplied by that concentration already described as C out. Exiting, we have one exiting stream going to the lower portion, which is going to be Fr times C1. Our accumulation term is going to represent the amount of mass of this component we have, and that can be represented by multiplying the volume of the upper portion, V1, by the concentration of the upper portion, C1. A similar balance ensues for the lower tank. Here we have one stream coming in, that's the one coming from the upper portion, FRC1. We have two streams exiting, one which is the one going to the upper portion, so it'll be minus FR times C out, minus the stream exiting the tank, which will just be F times C out. And in this case here, the amount of material in the lower portion can be described as its volume, V2, multiplied by its concentration, C out. So what we now want to do is begin to get this into the Laplace domain, but we're going to do a couple quick things before that. We're going to do two things with these balances. We're going to, one, factor out the volumes, and two, we're going to put into deviation variables. Here, because we're assuming that the flow rates are constant, so the only things that can vary the concentrations, all the terms here are linear. So what this means is the fact that we can easily replace all of the C values that we have with C prime, because there's no difference in the deviation and the non-deviation in this situation if you were to go through the process and subtract off the steady state equation. So by doing this, what we're now left with is that V1 times dC1 dt, put the prime in, equals F times C in prime plus FR times C out prime minus FR times C1 prime. And again, this is for the upper portion of the tank. And for the lower portion of the tank, it'll be something very similar. From here, we'll take the Laplace transform of this. For the upper tank, we'll have V1 times, putting a capital C to indicate that we're in the Laplace domain, And then we'll just do something very similar for the capitals for the remaining terms. And a similar logic ensues for the lower tank. So remember that our goal here is to find a transfer function that relates C out to C in. We have C out is a function of C1, and then from the first bound, see that C1 is a function of C in and C out, hence the interacting nature of this process. So what we want to do here is develop both into transfer function form. Therefore, we're going to gather the like terms for the term with the S. So therefore, when we rearrange, what we end up with is, and similarly for the lower tank, we end up with, so now we'll put these into transfer function form. And when we do this, we'll have C1 prime will equal F over V1S plus FR multiplied by C in prime plus FR divided by that same denominator. And this we multiply by C out prime. And then similar here, C out prime equals FR divided by V2S plus FR plus F multiplied by C1 prime. Notice that our top equation for the upper portion is an equation explicit for C1 prime, and all I need from C out prime is that exact term. So therefore, we're going to substitute in. So this is going to get a little messy algebraically. So again, in order to get our final transfer function of C out prime over C in prime, we have to gather the C out prime terms together. So if we factor out the C out prime part and move the C in prime over, we actually have our transfer function. To make this a little cleaner to write right now, I'm going to call this term G1 and this term G2. C out prime over C in prime equals G2 divided by 1 minus G1. If you notice, both G1 and G2 have a least common denominator, so therefore we can simplify this, and what we'll end up with is FRF over V2S plus FR plus F multiplied by V1S plus FR minus FR squared. Because of the coupledness of the differential equations slash transfer functions, because of the fact that they're interacting, it causes our solutions to be a bit more complicated than for non-interacting systems where the relationships between the input and output variables are very cleanly sequential.